a teacher per se, as you turn your Bibles or your iPads or your iPhones to Acts. But I've asked the Lord to grace me tonight. And as you turn to Acts 19, to grace me to teach a little bit on something that is very important, especially to our Pentecostal heritage. Turn to your neighbor and say, go to the first one, please. Can you go to the title? Okay, now wait for me a little bit if you would, please. Turn to your neighbor and say, I'm anointed for this. Oh, come on. Say it like you mean it. Say, I'm anointed for this. Amen. I forgot to call you people up to the front. You got away with it today, but I'll catch you next week. Thank you. We need to get used to sitting up in the front so we can come together and feel the presence of God together. So go with me to Acts chapter 19, if you would, please. Let's begin reading in verse 11. Now God worked unusual miracles by the hands of Paul, so that even handkerchiefs or aprons were brought from his body to the sick, and the diseases left them. Then some of the itinerant Jewish exorcists took it upon themselves to call the name of the Lord Jesus over those who had evil spirits, saying, we exorcise you or by the Jesus whom Paul preaches. Now, God was moving. Paul was doing all kinds of great things. God was bringing all kinds of miracles, and the Jewish leaders were watching this, and so they thought they could do it. And so they were trying to copy what Paul was doing. And they said, by the name that Paul uses, the name of Jesus that Paul uses, by the name of Jesus whom Paul preaches. Verse 14, also there were seven sons of Sceva, a Jewish chief priest, who did so. He did the same. And the evil spirit answered and said, listen. The evil spirit answered and said, verse 15, Jesus I know, and Paul I know, but who are you? And you would be surprised that if Christ manifested in the flesh, stood right here tonight, and pointed at you and said, who are you? You would not have any idea. You wouldn't know what to say. And that's why the devil wreaks so much havoc on God's people who do not know nor understand who they are in Christ. And as long as you have a lack of knowledge of who you are in Christ Jesus, please hear me as I speak the truth to you tonight. That the enemy will continue to come and wreak havoc on your life or on your household, on the lives of your kids, because the head of the household doesn't even know who they are. And as long as you don't know who you are in Christ, the enemy will run free and he'll run rampant in everything that you do. And people, as much as I preach and I teach this, people take this so lightly. I teach people, hey, how you doing today? I teach them how to say, I'm blessed, because that's who they are in Christ Jesus. And they'll say, I'm all right. And I often pray, God, open the ears of these people and our people to understand and to begin to learn the truth of who they are. There's a lot of people say, well, you know, I'm just an old sinner saved by grace. Oh, well, let me ask you a question. Let me ask you something. Are you a sinner or are you saved? Are you a sinner or are you saved? And that means that when you sin, it's not natural for you anymore. You know you've sinned and you can hardly wait to ask God to forgive you of your sins so you can go on. But when you were a sinner and you weren't saved, every time you sinned, it didn't matter to you because that was your nature. But now that you're saved, your nature is changed. You're no longer a sinner. You're a child of God who still messes up but doesn't say it's all right. Every time we mess up, we run to God, ask for forgiveness, and let God pick us up and go again. Now, this thing sometimes that sometimes people abuse that and say, well, you know, I'm just an old sinner saved by grace. And really what they're doing, maybe not all, but many, really what they're doing is they're already making an excuse for the next time they mess up. Well, you know, I'm just a sinner saved by grace. And that so depletes what Jesus Christ has done on the cross. He didn't shed his blood for you to stay a sinner. And it's obvious I may not finish this teaching today. It may have to be part two. That kind of attitude, as humble as you think it is, and as humble as it sounds, is not what Jesus is teaching us. That so depletes or so, God, I can't even think of the word, minimizes, and that's a weak word, for what Christ has done on the cross for us. He didn't shed his precious blood for you to just be an old sinner saved by grace. And oftentimes it has been my observation in the years that I've ministered, oftentimes people concentrate on the I'm a sinner more than they do saved by grace. And you can understand how the enemy would love to just pounce on that and beat you up with that. And he has. That's what makes what I'm attempting to relate to you tonight so important. So the seven sons of Sceva, the old evil spirit, said to them when they tried to imitate, say imitate, shout imitate. When they tried to imitate Paul, the evil spirit said, Jesus I know and Paul I know, but who are you? ¿Quién eres? ¿Qué traes? Huh? Who are you? He says, I know Jesus. I know Paul. But I don't know you, and you're trying to do what Jesus and Paul, you're trying to do what they're doing, but who do you think you are? Who do you think you are? Who are you? Okay, no, let's go on. Okay. Getting out of hand here. Verse 16, then the man in whom the evil spirit was leaped on them, on the seven sons of Sceva, overpowered them, and prevailed against them, so they fled out of that house naked and wounded. How embarrassing. He embarrassed them. They tried to cast the devil out, but they were doing it copying Paul. The devil said, I know Jesus, I know Paul, but who are you? They got embarrassed that the enemy stripped him naked and chased him out of the house. Embarrassment. Verse 17, this became known both to all Jews and Greeks dwelling in Ephesus, and fear fell on them all, and the name of the Lord Jesus was magnified. Verse 14, also there were seven sons of Sceva, Jewish chief priests who did so, and the evil spirit answered and said, Jesus I know, and Paul I know, but who are you? Stand up. I want you to repeat this after me. Real loud. Say real loud.
Real loud.
Say this. Repeat this after me. I'm anointed to live this life.
I'm anointed to live this life.
Say it again.
I'm anointed to live this life.
Say it one more time.
I'm anointed to live this life.
Now, if you believe that, as I do, If you believe that as I do, then you're telling me that you believe that you're ultimately going to be victorious. No matter what you're going through right now, you believe with all of your heart you're going to be victorious in spite of every test, in spite of every challenge, because you're anointed to live this life. Now repeat after me. Say yes.
Yes.
Say yes.
Yes.
I believe that.
I believe that.
Because I am anointed. Come on, I am anointed to live this life victoriously. Give the Lord a praise. You may sit down. That's what I want to talk to you about. I want to talk to you about God's anointing the next few minutes I have left. The anointing, understand first of all that the anointing is God's power. But understand that it doesn't, the anointing does not enable you. It's not for you to live your life. The anointing enables you to live the life that God has predetermined for you to live. God does not anoint you, hear me please. God does not anoint you for you to do your own thing. And then you say, come over here, God, or come over here and help me do my thing. God does not anoint you to do what you want to do. God anoints you to do what he has predetermined for you to do. Turn to somebody and say, God's got an anointed plan for your life. God is here to fulfill his program and not yours. And when you get with God's program, turn to your neighbor and say, God gets with you. Tell him. When you get with God's program, God gets with you. The anointing is also the enabling power that enables you and quickens you and strengthens you when having to perform things that you could not do in your own strength. Follow me, please. The anointing, hear this, very important. The anointing can cause people to make misjudgments and misassessments about you. They see you do things under the anointing, hear this, and they think that it is easier than it actually is. They saw Paul doing what he was doing, and the sons of Sceva thought it was easier than it actually is. Because when the anointing is operating, it looks easy, but it doesn't mean it is easy. There is a price one must pay for the anointing of God over their lives. They think when they see you moving in the anointing and people are getting healed and people are getting restored and God is moving, people begin to think that it's easier than it actually is. They don't understand that the anointing is one who comes along to help you. They don't understand, hear me now, that God adds his super, he adds it to the natural, and then God enables you to do supernatural things, not because of you, but because of God's anointing operating in your life. Yeah, I got it out. Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Look at your neighbor and say, the anointed is God's anointing. It's God's anointing. Tell them it's God's anointing. And so when people see you do this, follow me now. This is good teaching. When people see you do this, people who stand on the outside will think that you're the strong one, but it's not you. It's God's anointing. Now, I want you to hear this next point because it's more real. A lot of people don't understand this. I want you to hear this next point. One of the challenges is that when people think you're strong, they won't minister to you. Oh, I know. You're right, sister. That's the truth. Take it from a veteran in the, well, two veterans from the things of God. That's the truth. When people think you're strong, they will not minister to you. Why? Because they don't think that you need any ministry. Oh, God. They see how strong you are. They don't know that it's the anointing, God's anointing operating through you. So they see how strong or how prophetic or how you operate in the gifts of God. And they don't know that it's the anointing. They don't understand it. And so God says, go minister. They say, oh, no, that might not be God. They don't need any ministry. Look at them. Oh, you have no idea. I said, you have no idea. You have no idea how I've gotten a text out of nowhere and somebody just encouraging me. And I text somebody. I said, oh, my God, you have no idea how much I needed to hear that. That alone is the anointing. So they don't think you need any kind of ministry. They don't think you need any kind of prayer. They don't think you need any kind of encouragement. I mean, look at you. You're laying hands on people. God's doing miracles. People are getting healed. You know, what could it ever be? What could you ever need from God? I need from God whatever you need from God. When you need it from God, we need it from God. It's not us. It's the anointing of God. Somebody praise his holy name. Get up and praise his holy name. Get up and praise his holy name. You see, you may be seated. You see, hear me now. I don't want you to miss this point. You see, when in reality, it is not your strength that enables you to do it, but it's the strength of the Almighty God. And here's what people don't understand, that under the anointing, look at me, underneath all that anointing, underneath the power of God operating in your life, operating through you, underneath all of that, there is a frail human being who sometimes gets intimidated and sometimes gets scared. But you don't see that when the anointing is operating. All you see is the anointing, but you don't see that under that anointing, there's a human being that hurts just like you hurt. There's a human being that struggles with things just like you struggle with things. There's a human being under that anointing that goes through hell just like you go through hell. The only difference is that they understand when the anointed is operating, they understand that they've been anointed to preach the gospel. They've been anointed to prophesy. They've been anointed to praise and worship. They understand that whatever it is they've been anointed to do, they're going to get up here, and they're not going to lean on their own strength and their own understanding. They're going to get up here, and they're going to lean on the anointing of God. They're going to depend on the anointing of God. And sometimes we have to lead while we bleed. We'll still be here because it's not us. It's God's anointing operating through our lives. Hey! You understand. It's not you. It's the empowerment of God. It's the anointing of God. And you better be careful, because once you begin to think that you are doing it and you don't give glory to God because it's his anointing, you must be careful, because there'll come a day. Understand something about this human being just like you. Understand, I didn't want this job. I was doing good, being the best usher my church ever had. I was doing good there. I have a heart for ushers and minister helps, because I was the best. Nobody ever told me I was. I just knew I was. I knew it. My shoes were polished, spit shine, huh, babe? I would sit in my living room, get my shoes, and heat up the wax, heat it up and melt. And then, what are you doing that for? Church. I'm an usher. I didn't have the best suits. But my wife would take me to the Goodwill store to find something to wear on Sunday morning. But look at me now. The anointing of God. the anointing of God, the call of God over your life. Somebody shout hallelujah. Turn to somebody and say, see, you didn't want to come to church tonight. You're all mad because, tell them, you're all mad because SC lost. Tell them, you're all mad. But understand, is this helping you? Understand that once that anointing lifts, my wife will tell you, once that anointing lifts, I can't even drive. I can't. There's times that people have had to drive me home. I'm serious. I can't drive because it once that anointing lifts, it takes so much out of you. So much out of you. Please hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. This is so good for you to understand. So you understand that underneath that anointing be the power of God operating through you. Underneath that anointing is a person just like you. That's why you can't put that person on a pedestal. I have never given any of you permission to put me on a pedestal. If you love me, you wouldn't do that to me. When you put a person on the pedestal, you're not putting the anointing on the pedestal. You're putting the person, and the person can fail you, but the anointing of God will never fail you. And yet, as frail as we are, and yet as human as we are, God enables us by His grace to do things that you have to stand back every once in a while. You got to stand back yourself and wonder, man, how did I ever make it through that? The anointing. How did I ever survive that? The anointing. How did I ever accomplish that? The anointing, the anointing, the anointing, the anointing. God's anointing. Somebody say God's anointing. And it was just God anointing you at the period of your life and that phase of your life. God was doing it through you. There's times that I can give somebody a word of knowledge or something. A week or two later, they'd call me back and say, do you remember what you said? No. They don't. Well, you should remember. No, I shouldn't. It wasn't me. It was the anointing of God. You want to know? Why don't you get on your knees and ask God yourself? Well, you're the pastor. Well, you're a son of God. He'll talk to you just as much as he talks to me. As a matter of fact, I am. As a matter of fact, Alicia, I am more surprised why I'm still preaching here, because there's a lot of people that hear the voice of God every single day. I hear the voice of God maybe once every 2 months. And people say, "What? Let me tell you what God told me today." Oh, no. Yeah, go ahead. And I go home like, God, I don't hear God that often. What the heck am I? You know, I feel bad. Maybe you ought to be preaching up here. There's a frail person under that anointing. There's a hurting person. People come to me and I say, you know, I'm going through the same thing you're going through. But you just know it wasn't me. God, through His anointing, just did that. It wasn't me. I'm just a vessel. I'm just one of them. I'm just one of them that God chooses to flow through. But it's not my power. It is God's power. I'm just a point of contact. You see, when I walk or when I call you up here and I lay hands on you, understand, it is not me. I'm just a point of contact. And when I lay my hands on you, I believe God's power anointing will flow through me to give you whatever you need. It's God's power. It's God anointing. So it's God giving the answer to your prayer, not the person. I think so, Pastor. Because He's a good God. Now, if you ever get that confused and begin to think that it is you and not God, you're setting yourself up for the greatest disappointment you've ever seen in your life. When God adds His increase into your life, can I go on? When God adds his increase into your life, you have supernatural strength. If you go and listen, if you go and pull the rock out of Goliath's forehead and you examine the rock, you'd find out that there was nothing exceptional about that rock. If you go and raise David from the dead and look at David's hand, you would find out that there was nothing exceptional about David's hand. And the Bible said that he had a slingshot, so we know there was nothing exceptional about that slingshot. And yet, it got an exceptional result. But it was God who got behind David's hand and David's slingshot and that rock. It was God that got behind him. And when David threw it, and God, it was God who caused it to be effective. It wasn't the special rock. It wasn't a special slingshot. It wasn't something special that David had in his hand. It was the anointing of God that got behind what David was doing. Why? Because David was doing what God had called him to do. Oh, you get rid of your own program and you get rid of your own agenda concerning the plan of God for your life, and you hook up with the plan of God, God will hook up with you. And you can't miss. You can't miss. Times I counsel with people, well, you know, this and that, and it hasn't happened. And I want to ask, well, is that what God wants for your life? The only reason sometimes I don't ask is I don't want to hear from that person. I don't know. That means I haven't sought God. I don't know means I haven't prayed. I don't know means I haven't fasted. So I don't ask because I don't want to hear it. Because you should know. Some of you have been serving God for I don't know how many years. You should know what God wants you to do for him. Somebody say, I should know. So all of you that are waiting on exceptional equipment before you get in the fight, you're gonna miss your life. You're gonna miss your life because God's strength is made perfect in weakness. Well, I'll wait till I get stronger in the Lord. No, God's strength is made perfect while you're still weak. Why can that be? Because it's not you, it's God. Well, thank you for your enthusiasm. You know, sometimes people tell me, well, you know, they got to be here a little longer. They got to grow a little more in the Lord. Why? It's not them. It's God. Yes, there might be some things they need to learn. I understand. But we never give the human, we never give the person the credit. We always give God the credit. God is the God's strength is made perfect in weakness. So if you're waiting for that special moment till God does this and till God does that, you're going to mess up your whole life waiting. The only way you know that you're anointed, hear this. The only way you know that you're anointed is when God takes substandard equipment, turn to somebody and say, that's us. When God takes substandard equipment and performs supernatural tasks, that's when you know you're anointed. When you know that you didn't deserve God using you that way, but God used you anyway, that's when you know you're anointed. When you had no idea what you were going to say or what you were going to sing or what you were going to do, and all of a sudden this idea came to you. It's not just any idea. It's a God idea, and God anoints you. If you obey that God idea, God anoints you to succeed in whatever direction he's given you. And you say, Lord, someone said, I don't see how in the world you could do this with me. I don't see how you could operate through me. And then God gets the glory because you recognize that it was not you that did it, but that God did it through you. I go to Rosarito a lot, and I see a lot of people parasailing. And you know, how many of you know what parasailing is? They get on this big kite, the boat, the rope, you know. And it looks really exciting. And I remember one time I went to Hawaii and I checked it out because I said to myself, well, I'm going to do it. I'm going to go parasailing in Hawaii. But I decided against it because I said, if something goes wrong, Charley, you've got to either be able to fly or to swim. and I can't fly and I can't swim that far, so I decided not to do it. But listen, point is this. But to all of those people who see other people do things like that and they want to go and try them, there's always a disclaimer. You've seen the commercials on TV. There's always a disclaimer that they put on at the end of the show that says, don't try this on your own. Because there are people who look across the room and see other people doing things. Hear me. And they think that because they are able to do it, they think that they can just jump up there and do it also. I don't see many of you running up here to preach. Matter of fact, I don't see any of you running up here to preach. Sometimes I wish you would. You could feel it. You could sense it. You could see God operate through you when nobody told you that God would ever use you. God will anoint you. When they said you'd never change, God will anoint you. When they said you'd never be any good, God will anoint you. God will anoint you. When they said you wouldn't break that habit, God will anoint you. And he'll shut them up. He'll shut them up because he'll operate and he'll move through you. Somebody say the anointing. So you need to understand, because people see you doing things under the anointing, they want to jump up and do it also, because they think it's easy. Now hear this next point. Not a point, but hear this, what I have to say next. This happens in church all the time. Look at me. Because we all know at least one person that this has happened to. This is what makes people start churches all the time. They see the anointing operating through one person, and they don't understand it's the anointing of God. And so just because they can do it, I can do it also. And they go out there and try to start churches, and it doesn't work. We all know people that have struggled with that. Because when the anointing is all over somebody that God is using, hear this, other people say, well, I could do that. And they jump up and they go start a ministry. Listen, have you ever been in the car? Have you ever been in the car and you be singing with a CD? You ever been in the car singing with a CD? Come on. Come on. Be mariachi or country or, you know, oldies. Ooh, you know, oldies. You ever been there? Ask your neighbor, have you ever sang along with a CD in your car? And then all of a sudden, you're singing all your heart out, man, you're Alicia Keys, and you know, I mean, you're James Brown getting down, and then, you know, you're just going for it. And then all of a sudden, the CD stops. Has that ever happened to you? And you realize, oh my God, I really can't sing. It was a CD. And then you realize, I really can't do that. It was the anointing. I really can't do this. It's the anointing. It's the anointing. It's the anointing. Oh, help me. Help me. Preach. Somebody shout, I'm anointed for this. And all of a sudden that CD stops. And what happens? I mean, hearing people who can really sing, here's the point, makes you feel like you can sing. But you know you can't. But hearing them sing and you singing along makes you think that you can sing. Get your iPod. Watch somebody get your iPod or get their iPod and put their ear thing, and they're on the bus or something. You walk by and they go, hey, oh, hey, oh, singing along with a song, and they think they're singing great, and you walk by and go, whoa. Huh? Have you ever seen that? But they don't know they're singing awful. They're singing along with a song, and they think that they're really singing good. Well, the anointing over somebody's life makes things seem overly simplistic. And it opens up great room for people to have great failure. And that's why you ought not to try to imitate other people's gifts. They tell me, you're a prophet. No, I'm not. I ain't no prophet. Why do you fight it? Because you guys are freaks. My sister Lydia, she's weird sometimes. It's part of the profession, part of that anointing. I tell her, I can't even learn how to pastor the church. You want me to be a prophet? You must not want to imitate other people's gifts. See, just because God gave it to one person to do it doesn't mean that someone else can do it. Here the Apostle Paul was so anointed. What time is it? Okay. Here the Apostle Paul was so anointed that he made ministry look easy. I mean, people were stepping into a shadow and they were getting healed. Read it. He had such power that he affected the atmosphere. And when you're really anointed, you don't even have to speak. Your presence affects the atmosphere because it's the presence of God over you. When was the last time somebody came to you and said, man, I see God all over you? You know what they're talking about? Talking about the anointing. I see God all over you. I see the presence. I see Christ. I see the anointing of God. Your presence, because you're anointed, affects the atmosphere. Somebody say, go ahead and teach, Pastor. Listen, if you're anointed to preach, sometimes you don't have to preach. You can walk out on the platform in your presence. The anointing commands a certain reaction because of the level or because of the gross weight of the anointing that rests on you. Somebody say that's God. His shadow, Paul's shadow, was falling on people. People were taking their handkerchiefs and putting them on their bodies after he would touch them, and they were being healed. Paul had so much anointing that anything connected to him was anointed. He was casting out devils. He was taking authority over demonic influence. And I'm not talking about people who act crazy and try to get up to the front so that they can get attention. I'm talking about a real spirit. Paul went right up and cast those demons out. No, he didn't beg them. Listen, he didn't plead with them. He didn't question them. He would just cast the devil out, because there's some devils you just have to cast out. You can't argue. You cannot negotiate. You can't talk to them. You just have to say, okay, this is it, in the name of Jesus. I've been surprised how I've cast out demons out of people here, and people that have been with me for years get scared because they've never seen anything like that. It's just the anointing. It's just the anointing. If God anoints you to do that, that's what you'll do. But it's not you. Turn to someone and say, it's just the anointing. Come on, say it like you mean it. Say, it's just the anointing. And so the seven sons of Sceva walked up, and they saw Paul casting out demonic spirits, and they said, listen to me, here's what they said. He said, hey, we can do this. If that guy can do it, we can do this. Now you have to understand that the seven sons of Sceva were the sons of a Jewish priest who didn't even believe in Christ, but they were attracted to the Christian power. They thought, we can get down his movements, Paul's movements. We can get down how he talks. We can say Shandai, Shandai, Shudabada Handai. We can do the Christian two-step. We can mimic his voice. We can do this. If he can do it, we can do this. I'm always astonished that when Hollywood gets ready to train an actor to play the role of a preacher, they always send him into a church service to take notes. Because they think that if they wear the right clothes and they get the right body language and they use the right words, but there's something about the anointing of God. You may be able to act like you're a boxer. You may be able to act like you're an airplane pilot. You may be able to act like you're a doctor, but you cannot act like you're anointed. You cannot act like you're anointed. You either are or you're not. You either are or you're not. Singers get up and sing, and they try to act like people who are anointed, and they got it down pat. You see it at American Idol all the time. They got it down pat. They know how to do the riffs, and they know how to do the runs, and they know how to do the emotions, but at the end of it all, it falls flat on their face because the anointing cannot be imitated, and God's anointed cannot be duplicated. It cannot be bought. It cannot be faked. You either have it or you don't. You're either anointed or you're not. I'm going to stop here. Give the Lord a praise. Come on, give the Lord a praise. Come on, give the Lord a real praise. Now, the reason I'm going to stop here is because part two, next Wednesday, can't miss it. Next Wednesday, I'm going to give you three very major points concerning the anointing. Do you have point number one up there? For example, point number one, victory is not as simple as it looks from the outside. Do you have point number two? More numbers doesn't necessarily mean more power. There were seven sons of Sceva. They thought they could do what one anointed man was doing. Got the next point? I don't know if I put it down. I didn't put it down? Okay. I'll put it down by next week. The anointing. The anointing. The anointing. The question tonight would be, yes, please. God has no problem anointing us. God's anointing was operating in me even while I was still missing out. And I'm grateful that it was, because it's the anointing of God that caused me to survive things that should have killed me because I was messing up. And when I think of that fact alone, I never take the anointing lightly. James said, "Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try that spirit to see if it is of God." And although I understand the anointing, I did it a while ago. I was praying, "Father, in the name of Jesus, if what I'm sensing in my heart is of you, then I receive it with an open heart, Father. But if what I'm sensing is not of you, then I bind and I rebuke it. And in the name of Jesus, I command to loose off of me now." And oftentimes you can just feel that thing just go, shh. And it was good and it was encouraging and it was sweet. And right there, people would have said, "Well, that's God." No, but it wasn't God. It wasn't anointed. And God lifted it off of me. Pastor Lydia, being walking in the office of a prophet or a child or any other true prophet, will tell you, you got to be so careful when you prophesy over somebody, because it can change their whole life radically from one day to the next, from one moment to the next. So you better know that what you're about to speak is God, and it's anointed of God, and that you're anointed and authorized by God to do that. That's why I warn you against parking lot prophets, people who will prophesy to you after your pastor has prayed with you, and after he's prophesied, they still have another word. Let me tell you, there was another word, God would have given it to your pastor. But I don't know what it is about people. They'll go out there and they'll just let anybody speak into their lives. Anybody. And call me. Now I'm supposed to undo what you should have never allowed to happen. Well, how do I stop it, Pastor? I've told you time and time again. When people outside this ministry, and you know who the preachers are, and you know who the prophet is, when people outside of that say, I've got a word for you, can I give it to you? you need to say, you know, can you run it by one of our pastors first? And if they feel it's God, then you can go ahead and they'll go ahead and give it to me. But you won't do it. You know why you won't do it? Because of your pride. Oh God, I'm preaching real good. And the pride is one of the worst enemies of God's anointing. Pride, Jesus hated all those things, especially pride. And it is that pride that'll cause you to miss the anointing of God over your life. You must be willing to submit. First of all, you must be willing to submit to God. If you don't have a spirit or desire to submit, first of all, to God before anything or anybody else, the anointing won't operate in your life. Because the anointing will not operate to fulfill what you want. God's anointing will only operate to fulfill what He's already determined to happen. When a prophet gives you a prophecy, how do you know it's right? Because 99.9% of the time, it confirms what God has already been speaking to you in your heart in one form or another. That's how you judge prophecy. But let me warn you, the greatest word of prophecy you could ever get is in here. Well, thank you for your enthusiasm. God will speak to you right here. The anointed word of God. Hallelujah. Well, now you have some little bit of insight into what ministry is like. Amen. Listen, it is God's desire to anoint every single one of you. You need to know that. You don't have to have anything special happening in your life. You don't have to have. I didn't graduate from high school. I should have. A couple of months before graduation, I took some bad advice and turned out too good. But by the grace of God, I'm here. Now, there are a lot of you here that are more educated than I am. A lot of here, people here that speak English better than I do. Every once in a while, I still say chicken. Every once in a while, I still say children. Every once in a while, I say sit the children in the chair. Because from I'm from Pacoima. Snapchat or what is it? Snapshack? Snack shack. I'm ready for the snap. Oh, snap. Oh, snap. There's nothing special about you at all. What makes you special is the anointing of God. And so you learn to say to yourself, greater is He that is in me than he that is in the world. Give the Lord a real praise. Come on. Come on. Give the Lord a real praise. Somebody shout hallelujah. Stand up. I love teaching this kind of stuff. There's so much to teach, and I don't even know half of it. In all my years of ministry, I've just begun to tap into the realities of the anointing. I wish I knew more. But I guess God knows I know what I need to know. And when I need to know more, He'll show me more. I believe that. Lift your hands. Throw your hands up in the air. Father, in the name of Jesus, You've been so gracious to us tonight by giving us the word that You've given us. And there is not one single person within the sound of my voice that You do not desire to enable, to empower, or to anoint. Father, I ask You in the name of Jesus to start in this house. I know Your heart for Your children. It's the same heart that You have for me. You may not be calling them all to preach, but You're calling them, every single one of them, You're calling them to do something for the kingdom. And You're not only calling them, but tonight You've begun to teach us that with the calling comes the enabling. For You'll never call Your children to do something You have never enabled them to do. That would be a cruel thing. You'll never call your children to do something that you personally have not equipped them to do. That would be a cruel thing. You've never called anybody to do something that you would not anoint them to do. You're not that kind of a God. And you see every hand that's raised here tonight, Lord. Whatever your plan is for them, not my plan, not their plan, whatever your plan is for them, anoint them now. Lift your hands. Anoint them now to fulfill every phase of that plan. Anoint them now. Now, in the name of Jesus. Only you can do this. Only you can anoint them. Only you can empower them to fulfill what you've called them to do. Everybody repeat after me. Say, Father. Come on, say, Father. I know how much you love me. And I know how much you care for me. And I know how special I am to you. I ask you now that in the name of Jesus, give me a plain revelation, a simple revelation of what it is you want me to do for the kingdom. Of what it is, come on, you want me to do in this house for your glory. And when you reveal that to me, I thank you that with the revelation will come the empowerment. With the revelation will come the ability. With the revelation will come the anointing to do what you're calling me to do. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you. Give the Lord a great big praise. Come on. Praise his holy name. Hallelujah. Give the Lord a praise for the anointing of God. Hallelujah. Do we have any announcements? A few announcements and then we'll be dismissed. God bless you abundantly.